والحمد لله ولا إله إلا الله والله أكبر ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته and welcome to a new episode of Islam Unveiled. I begin by praising Allah the Almighty and sending the best peace and salutation upon His Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and the rest of His prophets and messengers. Then, brothers and sisters everywhere, I greet you with the greeting of Islam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We had the opportunity to discuss the meaning of Islam, which is submission, the concept of God in Islam, whom do Muslims worship, the concept of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in Islam, and how much Muslims do revere him. Then we also discussed the concept of mankind in Islam as well, and tolerance in Islam. But many people are asking right now, if somebody wanted to be a member of this religion, to adopt this faith and this religion as a way of life, what do they need to believe in? Many people say that we believe in one God. But this statement is not exactly true in most cases. When it comes to reality, we find out that it is just a word. But what are the outcomes of faith in Islam? If somebody wanted to be a Muslim, we Muslims, what do we believe in? We will not find any better than Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, himself, transmitting to us the message of Allah, telling us exactly what God wants from us in order to be true Muslims, in order to believe in Him in a proper way. The Quran talked about that, and Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, also stated that in his traditions. One day, Angel Gabriel, peace be upon him, came to him, and he inquired about Iman or faith. He said, what's Iman? What's faith and belief? So Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said, Al-Iman is to believe in Allah, in His books, in His angels, in His messengers, and in the last day, and in His divine destiny, it's good and it's bad. So when we look back at the answer of this question, we'll find that there are six articles of faith. First of all, if anyone wants to become a believer or a Muslim, he must believe in those six articles collectively. He cannot pick and choose. He cannot say, I'm not convinced about the hereafter. Yeah, I believe in everything, but I don't think that there will be a day of resurrection and people will have to enter heaven or hellfire. I believe that everybody will make it to heaven. No. Belief is to adopt a certain thing that settles in your heart, based on a communication with God through the messengers. So you adopt it as is. You do not add to it or subtract from it based on your whim or desire. Once again, righteousness and faith and belief means to believe in Allah, His angels, His books, and His messengers. And in the last day, it's reality and it will take place. And the sixth article of faith is to believe in His divine destiny. And we really deserve to spend some quality time explaining each and every one of those articles of faith, because you cannot believe in anything unless if you're fully aware of it, right? So, what is the meaning of believing in Allah? أن تؤمن بالله, to believe in His oneness, in His unity of Lordship, that there is no creator but Him. No one competes with Allah the Almighty in the creation of anything. Allah says in the Quran, Allahu khaliqu kulli shay. It is Allah who created everything. He is the creator of everything. And that would lead us to learn about the traits of the creator, who has the beautiful names and attributes. None of His traits would resemble the traits of the creatures. or of his creation, because he's the creator. You can never compare the creator to his creation. We may have the same name. Like when we say Allah is the all hearer, he hears. We too hear, but there is no comparison between our hearing and the ultimate vast hearing of Allah the Almighty. He has no barriers, he has no limits. He hears everywhere, he knows what's going on everywhere. He doesn't have to put spies or microphones in order to magnify the sound, no. If you are sitting in a secret council, he hears exactly what you're talking about. Not only that, if you're even talking to yourself without uttering words, if you're just speaking to yourself, if you're daydreaming, he knows exactly what's going on in your heart and mind. Then this is Allah. No one can compete with Allah in these qualities. So once we believe in the unity of the Lordship and He is the only Creator, then we must understand that this Creator deserves to be worshipped. So worship is to obey Him. And that's indeed the unity of worship. Not to worship others but Him. Not to take intermediaries as means of connection between you and Him. Not to ask from others but from Him. Not to beg from others but from Him. If you commit sins and indulge into faults and mistakes, you don't need to apologize to anyone but to Him. You don't need to ask for forgiveness from anyone but from Him. You should not expect any acceptance of repentance but from Him. Going to any holy man or any person in order to assist you with this regard, no one is better than you with regards to communicating with God. In Islam, if any person wanted to communicate with God, it is as simple as just calling on Him directly. In Islam, if anyone wanted to hear from God directly, it is as simple as opening his book, the Quran, and reading His word, which has not been changed nor altered, not even a single letter of it, ever since it was revealed, as He stated that in the Quran. So in brief, believing in Allah and in His oneness means to believe in the unity of the Lordship. This universe and everything that's in it has been created by a Creator, and He is the only Creator. Second, this Creator is the only one who is worthy of worship. And worship is not only praying or fasting or performing pilgrimage to holy places, but worship is when you submit yourself totally to Him. So obeying Him in any command and abstaining from any prohibition or anything that might displease Him is actually an act of worship. Being inclined to the love of what He loves is an act of worship. Disliking what He disapproves is also an act of worship. Consuming and indulging in what's lawful is also an act of worship. So worship in Islam is much broader meaning than just praying or attending the service in a place of worship such as a mosque or a masjid, etc. Furthermore, there are certain things that a believer has to be fully aware of, such as his names, his beautiful traits and attributes, which reflect magnificent meanings. It is not only about memorizing them or learning about them. It is also about living in those beautiful meanings of His names and attributes. For instance, in one beautiful hadith, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said, Allah the Almighty has 99 beautiful names. Whomsoever memorizes them shall enter paradise. This is a literal translation of his statement. But it has a greater meaning than just memorizing. And it also not limited to 99 names. Do you think Allah, the only Creator, the only one who is worthy of worship, would only have 99 names? Human beings in this life may have so many different names and titles, right? But Allah the Almighty in this hadith, Prophet Muhammad is telling us about some of his names. But his names and his beautiful attributes are beyond count, similar to his blessings and grace. In one verse in the Quran, particularly in chapter An-Nahl or the honeybees, Allah the Almighty says, وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَغَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ If you try to count Allah's favors upon you, never will you be able to count them. You cannot keep record. Why? Because they are beyond count. Indeed, Allah is the most forgiving for our shortcomings, the most merciful with us, even though we indulge into sins and disobedience day and night. In a beautiful way, Allah brings to our attention that even though we are big-time sinners, He is the most forgiving and the most merciful. Even though we cannot meet the countless blessings of Allah with enough gratitude and thanks, He meets all of that with forgiveness and covers us with His mercy. So if we just choose one of those beautiful names, such as Al-Alim, the All-Knowing, if I believe that my Lord, the only Creator, the only God who is worthy of worship, is All-Knowing, so there are no hiddens for Him or from Him, it would really make me feel shy from disobeying Him even in private, because the word Al-Alim, the All-Knowing, inspires me to respect Him and be aware of His presence in private as well as in public. Well, let's take a short break and we'll return back very soon with the rest of how to worship Allah properly by recognizing His beautiful names and attributes. Please stay tuned. Subhanallah
walhamdulillah. If you're 18 or if you're 80, if you've been Muslim for 50 years or 5 minutes, this is a show for you. You know, when 5 times a day our foreheads touch the ground in prayer, we beg for what's most important in our lives. We want to be good people, better Muslims. We want to serve Allah Almighty with all our hearts. In the show Let's Talk, every week we're going to talk about Islam and life, how to relate with other people and how to serve Allah. We'll have studio guests, we'll have a live studio audience. There'll be an email for you to write to, talk@huda.tv. So if you're looking for something different, looking for something that will make you think, maybe even touch your heart, this is the show for you.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back. I'm very sure that we need days and days and days in order to speak about some of His beautiful names and attributes and their meanings, in order to learn what does each name and attribute signify. But in brief, let's shed some light on a few of His beautiful names, such as Al-Razzaq. He is the only provider. He is the sustainer. So why would people tend to steal? Why would people tend to earn their provision unlawfully if all the means of provision are being controlled by Him? He is the one who sends down the rain in order to bring forth the fruits and vegetations to feed us, in order for the livestock to grow so that we can eat from them. If He decides at any set time to deprive us from food, from life, He would, and no one can provide us. No one else other than Allah the Almighty can provide us. This is why when we turn to say that we should only put our trust in God, people, in order to understand what is the meaning of truly putting your trust in God, only trust in Him, what does it mean? Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, says, well, if you people truly put your trust in Allah, He certainly would provide for you as He does provide for birds. Birds leave early morning to look for their food with their empty stomachs, and they return home to their nest with their stomachs full of food. Who provided them? Do they have a job? Do they have a place of work where they sign in and out, clock in and out, and they get paid? No. they leave early morning and only Allah knows where and how and when will they get their provision. But they make the effort and God provides for them because they trust Him more than we do. So if humans, if the believers put their trust in Allah by adopting number one, the permissible means of seeking provision, then relying on Him, not trusting other than Allah. What do I mean with that? I mean, when you know that Allah is a provider, that you should not seek your provision from unlawful sources. You should not try to work in a job which God prohibited. You should not try to steal or charge extra for something that Allah has commanded to charge a certain rate. You should not try to rip people off. Why? Because your provision is preserved with Allah and you will only get what Allah have destined you for. When you have this concept settled in your heart, you live in peace and you also enjoy your life and die in peace. You don't feel that you missed anything because you know you have a certain provision and you will get it definitely no matter what happens. And accordingly, you will not seek the help of no one but God. If Allah the Almighty is the one who benefits and He's the only one who can protect us from any harm, so why would some people wear a cross or a talisman or an amulet in order to gain some benefit or protect themselves from any harm, assuming that this little thing or this little angel or the penny which has an angel picture or even some Muslims who are not fully aware of their belief, they may do that sometimes. They wear a bracelet, a rubber bracelet. The other day I asked a person, what is this? I was at one of the airports and I recognized this guy is a Muslim. I said, what is this for? He said, it is to bring a good luck. It is very silly to trust a piece of rubber or a horseshoe or a rabbit foot or can bring a good luck or protect you from any harm. That contradicts the concept of faith. In a way, the person is sitting partners to Allah in worship. And what kind of partner is it? Well, the idol worshippers used to worship idols, take them as intermediaries between them and God. You are taking this piece of rubber as a link between you and God. He says, I believe in God, but it would bring me a good luck. Till this moment, I cannot relate, I cannot understand how would a piece of rubber or an amulet, or a cross, or bring a good luck to a person while it is dead, lifeless. It cannot even control anything to itself. If you decide to tear it apart, it would not object. If you throw it in the fireplace, it would not say no. It would not protect itself. Similarly, when we go to fortune tellers and ask them about hidden things, or somebody committed theft and we don't know who did, and we ask a human being to find out who did via trying to find out the unseen. By that, we're undermining our belief and we're committing an act of sitting partners to Allah in worship. Indirectly, how? By assuming that this person or that person know the future or know the unseen. You have to understand your limits. You have to understand your capacities as humans. As humans, we only know about what we could see and visualize. And we know about the past if we've been informed about it. And we know about the future if there is a prophecy about it in a confirmed book, such as the Quran, or by the Prophet, such as the statements of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Beyond that, no one knows anything about the unseen. So you cannot say, for instance, so-and-so predicted that the Day of Judgment will take place on that date or this calendar. All of that is false. Or somebody, a palmist, would read your palm and will tell you that you will get married to this girl and you will make that much money or you invest here. All of that is prohibited. That contradicts the concept of believing in God. No one knows the unseen but Him. No one brings the good luck but Him. No one protects from any harm but Him. And that's why if you need to seek help, if you need to invoke, if you need to seek refuge, then there is only one whom you should turn to. That is Allah and only Allah. Somebody has a question here.
My name is Irving from Slovenia, and I have a question. Why was there a need for another revelation while there has already been one?
Well, thank you so much. I guess you're asking the question relating to what I started by saying, that the articles of faith is to believe in Allah, in His angels, in His books. So I stated in plural, in His books. Why did Allah reveal more than one book? And what was the need for sending more than one book and more than one messenger? In brief, because we'll have a chance to elaborate on that furthermore in the next episodes, that every prophet before Muhammad, peace be upon him, had been sent exclusively to his people. And his book was for his area, for his era, for his age, for his time, and the successor, succeeding generations. But people do change. They do not only change themselves, they also change the revelations. To the point that most of the books which have been revealed before the Quran maintain very little of the original text, and some maintain none of the word of God. They have been totally altered. So accordingly, God has to send a new message confirming the previous message. It is not any different, because as Allah stated in the Quran, إِنَّ الدِّينَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ الْإِسْلَامِ. If you have a chance to look at all the previous books and hear from all the previous messengers, we'll find that their statement coincide each other. And with regards to the concept of faith and belief, it is very identical, because the one who sent all of them is one. God. He is the God of all the messengers, all the books, all the people, and that's why he has not changed, and his message was not any different. But people do change. Any questions before the end of the program?
I'm Ataullah from India. Just I would like to ask, every messenger has a miracle, but what is the miracle of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam?
That's a very good question. Every messenger has a materialistic or a tangible miracle. But what is the miracle of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam have so many miracles. Those miracles which happened with him during his life, we'll talk about them in details in the episode where we'll talk about the rest of the messengers and believing in them. But the greatest miracle ever, whether of Prophet Muhammad or all the prophets before him, was the miracle of the Quran. Why? Because every miracle that preceded Prophet Muhammad or came with any prophet before Muhammad have vanished. Where is Moses' stick? Where is it? We know that Jesus, peace be upon him, used to cure the leper and the blind people. Where is that now? It doesn't exist anymore. Where is the miracle of Prophet Abraham when he was cast in fire and he was not burned? It's gone with him. Where is the miracle of Prophet Noah, the ark? Where is? But the miracle of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is the Quran, the everlasting truth, is the miracle of all miracles, and it is the everlasting miracle. And I hope that in the future we'll have a chance to elaborate further more on the miracle of the Quran and why is it considered the miracle of all miracles. But now, again, with the concept of believing in one God. When somebody says, I believe in monotheism, it is not just a word. It's a word which requires implementation of certain acts, believing in certain articles, believing in certain commands that God have commanded, that he cannot say, I only believe in one God, and you stretch out your hand to a palmist or a palm leader to tell you your future, then you don't believe in him. You cannot say, I only believe in one God, and you carry an amulet or a talisman in your pocket as a means of protection, or you're hanging a horseshoe against your Mercedes or against your front door in order to protect you against the evil eye. You cannot say, I only believe in one God, and you rely on your checkbook or in your credit card. You feel self-sufficient and independent. Everybody has to know that richness and poverty, all from God. One day, I was watching after the calamity of the collapse of the stock market in Wall Street, some people who one day happened to be billionaires ended up working in Walmart once again in order to survive. They lost their houses, they lost their luxurious cars, so you cannot rely on anything in this life. Even if you possess it in your hand, you should only rely on Allah. Allah is the one whom you should put your trust in. And to be continued, inshallah, next episode. I leave you in peace. This is all the time we have in this episode. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Subhanallah walhamdulillah wa la ilaha illallah wallahu akbar wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billahil aliyyil azim. Glory be to Allah, all praise to Allah. There is no God but Allah, Allah is great. All power and might belong to Allah, the Most High, the Great.